let's talk a little bit more in detail about the teams. Unfortunately, DTI is out, so that's what you can see right now on the screen. Even though no matches were played, we can see all Endgegner and Pondgard already have a few wins here. This is just to make the scores appropriately displayed. And this is also a little bit of shame that DTI couldn't make it because they are EU1 team, right? So if they would be in, we would have EU1, EU2, and NA. So very nice mishmash, very nice mix. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, they are out, so let's focus right now on Endgegner and Pondgard. Guys, if you don't know, Endgegner is coming from EU2. They are coming from a house with the same name, Endgegner, and they are international house. Also, they have international lineup here coming to the tournament, consisting of German, French, Spanish, Portuguese, Slovenian, Serbian, Iranian, Swiss, Austrian, and even some Polish guys. There might be, as we have some small, slightly outdated information, there might be even more nationalities being represented on the tournament, but hopefully we'll be able to fix the information coming further. Compared to the Pondgard, this is a little bit different, considering that they are American and Canadian only, right? So you have all people speaking English as their main language, you have all people working together in same time zone or similar time zones, right? Because North America have a few time zones, but you know, very similar thinking, very similar cultures, and we will see if this will be reflected in their play style. So they are from NA, the Pondgard team, and they like competitive gameplay. They're aiming for first place. So gonna be very interesting, considering that Endgegner also is going to aim for the top. Both of the teams are have quite a lot of achievements when it comes to the territory wars and the normal gameplay. So they have conquered a few capital cities a few times. Pondgard have held the main objective for four seasons, and Gegner, I believe, for last two seasons. So this is indeed very, very interesting stuff. And definitely considering that they also played in many, many, many tournaments, considering or putting here in line the official Booming Games tournament that was hosted some time back, core tournament currently, and Aritournament one as well, this is going to be a great matchup against them. So CB, what else can you tell us?
Yeah, it's not just the teams that have been performing great, their players are also excellent, right? We are seeing players that are like really commonly placed in the top 100 of ranked battles. I know you and I play ranked, we play each other, I think it was last day or 2 days ago.
Yeah.
It was a pretty fun game, you stumped me quite a bit there. I think you might have targeted me. But we know that these players are really good. Players like Susno, he was top 8. I think he's back down to top 50 right now. But also on the NA side, we got like Toad King, Pian, Giotto. These are all like so, so very good at this game. Pian had the highest level for the Pondgard team with 2,720. And their current rank for Toad King was 5th, Giotto 7th, Pian 9th. So these guys are so, so good at this game. And you can see it also in the stats, right? Giotto averaged 137 unit kills. That's pretty good. We've seen those numbers from other great players from other teams, but they can do it as well. And Ripcats with 10 hero average kills. And yeah, he's here as well today. So I wonder what class he plays, but I would look forward to a game where he gets 10 hero kills. Let's see it. Let's see it happen. So yeah, both teams have excellent players, and for Endgegner, we're looking at the Alpha Poo, but also at Susno, of course. He's their captain, he's saying he's not their star player, but he's really good as well. And also Magner, he's been the MVP as well as Novelty in quite a few games, so they're all like very good players. Excellent, yep.
Sure. Alright guys, so seems like we have a very interesting thing coming up ahead of us. My co-caster, who is usually sitting over there, right there, is right now missing. And he's missing for a good reason. He is going to join Pondgard team, and he will be playing along with a German co-caster, Samuel. They will be playing with Pondgard. Unfortunately, Pondgard, two of their players couldn't make it. They, you know, coming from NA, they have vast time difference, right? It's very big. Guys who live in the West Coast, they have like 6 a.m. or something like that for them, and it might be problematic if someone works late or whatever, right, to join in on such a short notice as well. So yeah, seems like Pondgard having right now 13 players and 2 streamers, or co-casters, I should say better, in team, will be ready in a moment. So we'll be starting shortly. Very interesting, very interesting. I did not expect something like that to happen. There is a lot of good luck. Have fun being right now placed on the chat. So both teams in very good moods, both teams in very high spirits. Definitely interesting to see what they will bring. As you know already, a short reminder, we will be playing on Harbour City, both of the games, so one attack and one defense. And if there will be need, we will go then to tiebreaker as well afterwards. So yeah, interesting thing. Guys, short reminder, we have just a moment before the game starts. If you have not yet placed your bet, exclamation mark bet on chat. And sorry, but it's too late actually. We are jumping into the game. I'm closing in the betting and let's switch the screen. Let's see the game happen. Crash? No, okay, it works. Cool. All right. Sound is good. Everything is in. So, guys, Harbour City. We have Endgegner on attack. We have defenders in form of Pondgard. So, we will see how it will go. Endgegner, as we can see, mainly heavy armor. We see 4 short swords, 2 glaive players, poleaxe, and 2 mouse. Also, 1 long sword have switched. But then also 4 medium armor, so that's interesting to see. One short bow, so we'll see if they will be focusing on players more. On the other end, for the Pondgard team, we can see a lot of mouse, and this makes sense. In defense, you take someone with a mouse and you just throw him out. That's a good idea. But also quite a lot of medium and light armor, 6 of those, so interesting to see. On the units, we see a lot of Armingers. This makes total sense to bring. Or maybe not a lot, only 2. And on Endgegner, actually much more. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 versus 2 Armiger Lancers. So Endgegner looking to bring it more to later stage of the game. If they will be able to push to the A without too much losses, and they can bring out all of these 8 Armiger Lancers versus 2 Armingers on Pondgard, they can be very, very, very hard to deal with. Especially that this map has a lot of space, a lot of different routes, a lot of different small roads where you can flank, where you can hide, where you can run around and utilize those horses to flank someone from back. So we will see if this will be used to their advantage. For now, let's see where the opening of the map goes. We can see all the players loaded, so no remake this time. We had some problems last week, but right now, no problem. We can see opening trebuchets, very good idea. Opening trebuchets already to destroy the artillery of the defenders. I would like to remind you right now that there is no artillery at all. You cannot place any additional artillery. Only things that are already placed on map can be used. Also, on top, you can see here we have 13 trebuchets left, because one more is flying in. You can also see units left and currently alive heroes. So, Pondgard. In defense, they are playing very, very nicely, utilizing the whole wall. Each artillery is being occupied. They want to shoot as much as they can. They want to utilize them as much as they can, because this is only advantage artillery-wise they have. Attackers, not only have the cannons and have fachas and whatnot, they also have 13 more trebuchets. So this will be quite crucial. We can see this artillery usage from defenders is very nice. Of course, it's much easier to shoot at towers because they are a very big target, but still, having those two towers destroyed will be very good from the time perspective for the defenders, right? Attackers have to wait right now for this tower to spawn. Attackers will have to push them once more, and this will lose a lot of time. We have seen this in Group B, where Lamaland were attacking, and they were at the cap point with a lot of units, but they just had this like 30 seconds more and they could win the game. Unfortunately, because they lost all the towers at the beginning, they couldn't do it. So yeah, this can be a crucial. We'll see if here in this matchup it will also be so important. We can see very standard placement from Pond Guard in defense. We can see a lot of units on this side of stairs, another big block of units waiting to move and counter, and Endgegner moves on these stairs, and then we can see a small defense force with one person, LLL, here watching the small gate, which is right now being destroyed, and he also have support from someone else with the shield, so we can see Imperial Pikes and shield units over here. For other things that are happening right now on the battle, seems like this tower will be destroyed as well in the last moment. Very good, so we have very nicely from Torgadon, from Dealer of For Life, also from Ripcats, muskets, shortbows were shooting this tower non-stop, and they managed to destroy it very close. So this is going to waste more time than even imagined. So we will see if this will come up for Endgegner at the end as a problem. Endgegner here not really pushing the small gate, they are just creating some pressure, but not too much. Other than that, they are waiting with their units. We can also see longbow from non-numerical shooting down the units here, trying to hold the tower a little bit more. Magner and Gigut trying to protect them with their horses, trying to protect them with their bodies. They managed to do it quite nicely for most of the time. Here ultimate was used to stop it a little bit. From other direction, actually, shortbow is also shooting, so they're doing good job. And look at that, they killed enough of Martellatoris to stop this tower of being pushed. Already so much time being lost on Endgegner. Very well played from Pondgar. And look at that, not necessarily too many units were lost right now. We can see only 41 units lost from Endgegner. And so much time was wasted. Very, very well done. This tower seems like it's full health. It's also being pushed with stalwarts, so this is going to definitely reach to the target. But will Endgegner want to use this tower? We will see. Some teams want to go ahead from here and already broke the stairs. Some teams want to directly go to the aid point, but this might... we'll have to see what Endgegner will decide. For now, another pike unit is coming to push here the tower. Gate, middle gate is also destroyed, so pretty much both gates destroyed, one tower in, another tower going to be also in a moment, and this third one also in like 20 seconds or so will be reaching the gate, the wall. So Endgegner, all openings are there for Endgegner. They can do whatever they want, wherever they want, they need to decide. And here they are slowly pushing in, and they are not seeing any defenders at all. This is very crazy what they are doing. Pond Guard, you can see they are doing something strange. They are giving up A point fully. Fully giving up A point. And at the end, when I thought about it a little bit more, it makes absolute sense. Guys, there is one advantage right now after the initial stage of the battle is finished. There is only one advantage that attackers have. These trebuchets. Where trebuchets work great? On walls. You can hit everything on the wall. If Pond Guard would be defending on the wall, they could be crushed down with the trebuchets. Or this move, where they moved down, they cannot be reached out. The walls are protecting them from trebuchet fire. They cannot do anything right now. And yeah, they are not using and losing any units. And considering how much time they were able to lose from with these tower moves and whatnot, they are in good position to, you know, defend what they want. But we can see here a very problematic thing. Pond guard right now have no one on top of walls to scout. And Endgegner noticed that, and they are using this very, very good to do a full rotation. And this is what we talked about in the beginning. Many Armingers on the field. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Armingers right now on the field. And Endgegner going to try to pressure the Pulas on the left side of the map. Let me zoom out a little bit on the map here as well. So you can see Pond Guard rotating a little bit late because vast majority of the forces from Endgegner, they are already behind. And also there is one big thing for this plus. Attackers can use trebuchet very well on this point. They can clear out defenders very well on this point. And what they will do? Look at that. They are just utilizing their horses, running fully around. Full around. Look at that. No one is pressuring the plus point. This is a little bit problematic for Pond Guard because they have mainly infantry units. They are slow to walk. They cannot rotate that fast. And we can see already Sharps player with spear on point with horses against defenders with no units at all. They are just having heroes here defending without any units. And very good trebuchets as well to close the rotations. Yes, some pikes were able to make it from Pond Guard, but and stop Endgegner here. But Endgegner very wisely choosing to push with some forces on the plus, because yeah, they didn't play everything on one card. They wanted to split forces. And only problematic thing is trebuchets. Yes, they are going to use another trebuchets. One question, why so late? Why so late? They have still 11 trebuchets left. They could use it much faster and clear out the defenders here or in the main cap or whatever. We can see still 4, 5, 6 and Gegner players trying to put pressure on the cap zone, but Pond Guard were able to defend their plus, were able to defend their cap point, and right now what we can see is they are crushing them from both ends. So this is going to be a bloodbath. Pushing from both ends, advancing, horses charging, everyone shooting, trebuchets flying around, trying to cut them off, but it was too late and too little. Good job with the Pond Guard defense. Very last time, but did it well. And in the meantime, Endgegner took so much time and attention of Pond Guard, no one was defending this plus point. Only Kritor is here with few units left, is holding up. He's very low HP, half HP only. Short sword, yes, hard to kill this guy, but with so many people attacking him, he's going to be dead in a matter of seconds. And this is plus point captured, the first plus point captured on this map we have seen so far from attacking side. So very well done on Endgegner. I wonder if this is what was planned. They wanted to just try to play aggressively on the back end, capture the attention of the Pond Guard and fake the capture and then move to this point. If so, very well executed, very well done, very well played. And right now we are in a very strange stalemate where many things can happen. First of all, 10 more trebuchets to be used and 7 more minutes. A lot of time for Endgegner to be used on the push. We can see right now they are splitting their forces a little bit. Most of their players coming in with the via standard route to the main cap, but we can see some people are putting pressure here, Trilling and Mastiff on the flank with their horses, going to bring some attention of Pond Guard to their end. We can see non-numerical, very well played, aggressive plays. He is able to spot and see all them and Endgegner units moving forward. And right now we are in the stalemate corner. Let's zoom in a little bit down, see what will happen. For the statistics so far, 400 units left, lost on Endgegner side, 200 on Pond Guard. So Pond Guard, yeah, 900 versus 1400 pretty much. 50% more units on the Pond Guard. But if Endgegner will be able to do one precise aggressive push, this difference will not matter. Pond Guard, you could have so much units, whatever, how many you want. If Endgegner will push you out, you will not be able to do anything. And we can see very nice use of Zikalian Militia. We can see very nice push of Stalwarts, also Fortebraches behind them, two units of Fortebraches, no, sorry, make it three. Counter Pikes advancing from Pond Guard, but they are being destroyed very fast, considering two Zikalian leeches throwing from the back, burning down a lot of units, and all those pikes. Holy moly. Triple pike setup and triple shield setup. Very well placed from Endgegner, advancing slightly, just meter by meter by meter, centimeter by centimeter. Very well played. And yeah, seems like they cleared all of the units from Pond Guard. Pond Guard right now, just few heroes left alive. They will try their best to try to defend here. Maximus being the only one on the point right now with short sword, trying to stay alive as much as he can. Remember that also Endgegner right now, they have trebuchets. They can cut off supplies from Pond Guard if they will play it well. Pond Guard trying their best right now, regrouped with some units. They are hidden behind this building, so yeah, not that easy for trebuchets to hit them. And we can see also some flank coming in from behind, but flank is being right now covered, so this is very good place. And yeah, only one player, Giotto, blocking the spawn. He's a spear player, not that much armor, not that much survivability. He's trying his best, and very well reaction from Pond Guard. Yeah, after this first push, Endgegner forces, they were in good shape when it comes to numbers, but when it comes to the health, most of them were very low on HP. And this allowed Pond Guard to regroup, allow Endgegner, you know, to be a little bit over-aggressive, because Endgegner also tried to push a little bit forward. And then by just, you know, taking one player at a time, and making him go and die at the point, but blocking the capture point, Pond Guard were able to regroup, retake their units, form a flank, small one, but still, right? Flanks grabbing attention is still a good thing when it comes to reattacking some spot. And then, yeah, very well played on their end. But let's look at the stats right now. 7 trebuchets still left for Endgegner. We'll see if they will use them. 3.5 minutes left, so they will have to move fast. When it comes to units, 550 left for Endgegner versus 997 for Pond Guard, so pretty much twice. So very nice play with units on that, in that regard. When it comes to heroes, hero lives, we can see few people who died 2 times from Endgegner. Few people, only one person who died twice in this critter is from Pond Guard. So very good on health as well. And yeah, this is going to be the last push. 3 minutes left. They will not have that much time left for many different actions. We can see halabarders coming in. We can see some namcans coming in from the attack. We can also see some shields, but not that much. And right now, Pond Guard playing more aggressively. I like this. I like this very much because behind this wall, you can hide quite well from the artillery of the trebuchets. So they are eliminating with moving so fast, so aggressively, they are eliminating two things. First one, advantage of the trebuchets. They cannot use trebuchets that well. Second one is time. The more aggressive they play, considering they have twice the amount of units, the more time they waste from Endgegner, the better for them. And this is what they decided to do. Full push, full aggressive. Yes, trebuchets are flying in. Doesn't matter. Just don't die. Lose your unit. Try to take as much unit from Endgegner as you can. And then go back, take a new one. We will be golden. That's their idea. That is what I imagine they are right now talking on their comms. And very well executed. Many of them have died. Right now, 2 more have died from Pond Guard. We can see only 9 people alive versus 15. So, yeah, this can be problematic if Endgegner will push aggressively enough. Considering they have 1 minute 30 seconds still, they can do it. They can push aggressively, and to be honest, with 200 units left, this is only thing they have left. Kind of a deathmatch. And, yeah, if you remember Aritournament 1, Endgegner unfortunately lost the deathmatch. They were defenders at that time, but they lost the deathmatch at the point. Right now, they have much more numbers in terms of heroes, but not that many units, unfortunately. Trebuchets as well coming, trying to cut off the supply. And yes, they have more people. They are blocking very nicely. They are capturing very good on the point. But yeah, seems that Pond Guard bringing in more units right now. They can choose whatever they want, they will be able to make it in time. Very well played. 60% capped. I think this is, yeah, this is the highest amount of capped end zone we've seen on this map compared to last week. But yeah, this is going to be end, unfortunately, for Endgegner with 170 units only left and 12 heroes. They will not be able to fight against so many units from Pond Guard. Yes, these are mainly gray or green units, right? We have seen a lot of pike militia here. We can see also some halabardiers, even some demise pikemen making it their way to the fight here. They are very numerous, not that strong, but very numerous, right? But yeah, so much pikes, so big blob of units. 5 seconds left, game over. Very well played from both teams. I need to take a short moment to drink something. We can watch the stats in the meantime. But yeah, considering how interesting the match was, the stats are reflected here as well very well. We can see Endgegner team, they played very, very, very nicely. They played together. They had a good plan. They executed it very well. And this is reflected in the statistics where pretty much everyone from the team have similar amount of unit skills. There is not that many differences, right? About 70, yeah, the average is like 70 or 80 or something like that. But yeah, like from average, the top unit killed from Alpha, only 40 or 50 more, right? Below average, only 30 or 40 less. So very well balanced gameplay. On the hero kills, we can see 5 kills from Trilling, playing spear. Spears, yes, very good at killing heroes. So yeah, very, very well played. On the other end, for Pond Guard, we can see Ripcats. I want to see what he played. I will rewatch the stream and the replays because I want to see what he played with to make 200 kills. A lot of kills was done by this player, so congratulations. 120 next follow-up, so pretty much half, right? When it comes to heroes, 5 killed by Giotto, spear player, 5 by Payan, their team leader, and glaive player, very well played. So yeah, for the statistics, nice stuff. I don't want to focus on the post-game analysis too much because it was, I guess you see what happened, right? 3 point A for free, very nice flank behind by Endgegner, capturing plus side, and then they tried to push the cap zone 2 times. So that's pretty much the whole game in short. But yeah, looking at how it went, I'm amazed, to be honest. Compared to what we've seen last week, the games were quite static. This time, much, much, much better.